morning of Sorrow Church. Let's all stand together, if you would, as we begin this morning with our first song, My Lighthouse.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. Oh, 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 oh. Safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. I won't hear what tomorrow brings. With each morning, rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Promise you will carry me safe to shore. Oh, 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 oh. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Far before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storm. Far before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storm. Far before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storm. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore. Oh, 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 oh. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore.
Amen. But you're not awake yet, so you're going to be awake on this next one. It's called You're the Fire.
Oh, your love is my delight. Oh, your grace is running wild. Oh, your mercy gives me life. You're the fire in my soul. I've been rescued by your love. I've been purchased with your blood. I've been set free, I'm alive. You're the fire in my soul. You're the fire in my soul. You're the fire down in my soul. Let it burn so the world may know. Feel its love, an empty hope. You're the fire in my soul. I've been rescued by your love. I've been purchased with your blood. I've been set free, I'm alive. You're the fire in my soul. You're the fire in my soul. You're the fire down in my soul. Let it burn so the world may know. Fearless love, unending hope. You're the fire in my soul.
Good morning. Thank you, Pastor Jamie. I love it when we do those songs. My Lighthouse is one of my favorite. All of our students know the motions to that, right? I think you guys do. No, everyone's like, oh my gosh, don't make me raise my hand. I know you know them, Sadie Scruton. I don't even know what they are. There is motions, though. Anyways, glad you're here today. Welcome to UBC. My name is Pastor Joel. Glad that you're here. If you're here for the very first time, or if you're new, you've been coming for a few weeks and haven't done this yet, before you leave today, make sure you stop by our Connect desk out in the lobby, and we've got a Connect card, something to put some information down on, and we've got a gift that we'd like to give to you if you do that. So make sure before you leave today, if you've not done that, if you're new, if you're a visitor, that you do that there in the lobby. I want to highlight a couple things in the bulletin. First, we'll go over some things happening this week to make you aware of. It's a big week. We've got Halloween coming up this weekend, trunk or treat. But before that, I'll let you know a couple other things going on. And then we'll jump ahead, and there are some things happening in November that I want to make you aware of. So this Wednesday, first things first, Wednesday, we have our high school Bible study. High school students, we meet. If you go outside the church, right back there in Maggie and I's house, and that is coming up this Wednesday. I made a joke in the first service about how we might, you know, depending on if my wife goes into labor or not, we might not have a high school Bible study that week. But yeah, so I wasn't allowed to make that joke second service, so I'm not going to. Just kidding. So that's Wednesday. And then Thursday, Trunk or Treat is happening. That is a pretty big event. If you are signed up and you have a car, raise your hand. Who's decorating? Oh, look at that. We got an awesome amount. Okay, good, good. If you have not, oh wait, you guys are. You okay? Hey. So in the first service, we didn't know if the Catalisos were going to take the cake this year, but I guess it's been decided. Every year, the Catalisos go all out and do something awesome. I think last year, you guys didn't do a setup. You're away, and somebody else was allowed to win that year. So sorry if you were about to go all out. You're going to lose to the Catalisos. I have no idea what they're doing, what they're planning, but it's going to be great. So trunk or treat on Thursday. If you have any questions about that, candy, getting a car, sign up, whatever, Jim Roberts is the person to contact there. That information is there in the bulletin. And then this is really important that we talk about this week, because if we don't, some of you guys will sleep in and forget about it. It's daylight savings time. Next week is when we fall back, okay? So just mark your calendars, be aware of that. I have no idea why we even do that. It doesn't make any sense. It gets dark at like 3:30 because of it. It does not make any sense. But we're falling back an hour. My wife was saying when she would drive home from school at 3:30 in the evenings in this time of year, it was getting dark already. It's like, why is it dark outside? It's 3:30. So mark your calendars. Daylight savings time is next week. Don't show up at the wrong time. And then coming up a couple of weeks from now is our November 9th ladies event. I want, the ladies ministry always gets some love. So make sure you sign up for that if you're going to attend. That is November 9th. The sign up deadline for that, I believe, is this coming Sunday. So you got one more week to get signed up for that. But do it sooner rather than later so they can get their numbers in and all the information there that they know who's going to be attending. I would encourage you to sign up for that. And then we've got, over the course of November, we get a lot of things happening. We've got Card Night, which is a big favorite that Kim and Ralph do every year. We have an EBC crossplay event coming up, and we also have Discover EBC. So if you've never taken Discover EBC, that's a great opportunity for you if you're considering becoming a member, or if you just want to know what's going on here. What do we believe? Who's that guy? Who's the guy singing? Who's the guy speaking? That's a way you can ask some of those questions and get some of those things answered at Discover EBC. So again, the information, how to sign up for that, it's all in the bulletin there. If you've never taken that class, even if you're not interested in becoming a member right just yet, I would encourage you to consider taking that class. It's really helpful in knowing what we believe and what we're all about. If you would like to give, you can do that here in person. You can do that online in the Church Center app, or through our website, we believe that's a form of worship, a way we can express an attitude of generosity. So if you'd like to do that, if you'd like to give back a portion of what God has given you, you can do that again online or in the boxes at the back of the room. But let's pray, and then we'll continue singing together. Father God, we thank you for this day, and Lord, we thank you for the seasons, and Lord, the leaves falling, the cold weather in the mornings, even the sun setting earlier and earlier. And God, we appreciate and are grateful for the way that you're working and moving now in this time here at EBC, God, and in all of our lives. Lord, we thank you for this series that Pastor Rick has been walking us through, Lord, as we go through the book of Revelation. God, I just ask that over the next hour or so, that you would just open up our hearts and our eyes and our minds to what it is you have for us through this book. God, you have written this book so that we can know you better, know your heart better, better love you and love others, to better serve you. God, we can read this book and be so confused at times and wonder what's going on and what are these different pictures and imagery and what's happening and what's going to happen. But God, we know that you are king and you reign over all things and you hold all things in your hand. God, we ask that you would just open our eyes to that this morning as we read through this book and as Pastor Rick walks us through this Revelation chapter 6. God, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, as you stand, you can try to talk to your neighbor and figure out something that's going to beat the Catalisos at Trunk or Treat on Friday night. Let's all stand together, say hello, shake a hand, give a hug. Let's welcome each other to Epsom Bible Church this morning.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love. We sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. I wanna see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love. Glory, pour out your power and love. As we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see you. Holy, holy.
Lord, thank you so much. What an incredible song for us to end on before we open your word, because it's where we ended last week. That same word repeated over and over and over again is what's going to be repeated forever, all eternity. And to hear the seraphim, the cherubim, to sing that, it's just absolutely amazing. And so God, I just pray this morning, I just pray that as we open your word, that God will just search your truth. Lord, may it be a comfort to us, even though it sounds very oxymoronic to where we're about ready to study, but may it be a comfort knowing, and may we be reminded throughout all this time, you're seated on your throne. God, you're not fretting, you're not worrying. You are sovereign and you're in control. And we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. But take your Bibles and turn to Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6, and I'm going to move the podium just over here. I'm not going to put it in the center. For some of you that like everything there, it'll drive you crazy. That's why I'm doing it. Anyways, my wife is still teaching at Monadnock at the ladies' conference there, and she's there till this afternoon, coming back tonight. Yes, so looking forward to her being back, but just thanking God for how he is using her over there at Camp Monadnock. Well, we're in the book of Revelation, chapter 6. I want you to turn there, but also put your finger there, or note that, but turn to Matthew chapter 24, because we're going to go in both places. As I want to repeat to you again that we're studying the book of Revelation, and we're studying it in its normal grammatical context. We're not trying to make it say anything else than what it says, as we read anything else. I mentioned to you this a few weeks ago, and I want to repeat to you again. If you take the book of Revelation and you make it say something it doesn't say, you say, well, it doesn't say that, it says something else. It's more symbolic, and it's more metaphorical. Then you know what I find? All of a sudden, when you question the book of Revelation that way, you begin to question the book of Genesis. And maybe the book of Genesis, that's not a six-day creation. Maybe evolution's part of that, and then you start questioning that. And then recently I found someone that once you start doing that and questioning the Word of God, that you can't take it in a normal, literal sense. If you begin, this one pastor, as I said, down south, said that you need to take the gospel and unhinge it from the Word of God and tie it to an event, not to a book. And so we got to be real careful when we open up God's word that we just read it and understand it within its normal grammatical context to what is being said. Now, we're in the book of Revelation. Here's my challenge. I'm going to teach through the book of Revelation, which, again, we're going to not do it in in-depth study because we're doing 12 weeks and we're doing 21 chapters. But also, I when doing that, I also want to teach you a little bit about future events, because so many other books of the Bible, you've got Isaiah, Ezekiel, and you've got 2 Thessalonians, you've got Joel, and you've got all these, Zechariah, that teach also about future events. I'm going to weave some of that in there as well so that you get a full and complete picture. But let me just show you now our future events timeline and kind of tell you where we're at. We said right here, we started off with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Obviously, over there is the Old Testament, all the way up to the end of the book of John. But when the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the church age started in Acts chapter 2. Church age now has been going on for 2,000 years, and we're still in it. The next thing we're looking for is the rapture of the church. Those of us who know Jesus Christ as a Savior, the Bible says that Jesus will come down in the clouds. He's not going to come down on earth. He's coming down to the clouds. He's going to call us up. In a moment, a twinkling of an eye, we're going to be changed. Boom. And so our bodies are going to be changed. The dead in Christ, those are Baptists. The dead in Christ, just kidding you, but I was a Baptist many years. So guess I still am. But anyways, they'll be raised first. And then they'll get their new bodies before we get ours, but then we'll be in heaven forever. And so at the rapture, we're going to be in heaven, we're going to have our new bodies, we're going to be in our eternal spirits, the old man is done away with, we are going to party in heaven. We're going to have an incredible time. It's going to be amazing. In fact, last week, we saw that, didn't we, a little bit? We got a little peek of the throne room of God in chapters 4 and 5 of the book of Revelation, and there the worship's going to go on. It's going to be amazing there. Then the next thing on the timetable is the tribulation period. And we're going to talk about that in the next 3 weeks. We're going to talk about the tribulation. At the end of the tribulation, Jesus comes all the way back down the earth. We're going to come with him. And judgment will happen at that point. And then there'll be a 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth. He'll literally reign on the earth. At the end of that, Satan will be released from the abyss one more time, one more rebellion, one more time to send him to the lake of fire, judgment, and then those of us that are saved in new heaven, new earth, and in the lake of fire. So we're going to talk about all these things as the time goes on. I'm going to add more to it. Now, some of you last week were trying to write down this chart. I'm going to give you the whole chart with all the details on it at the end, but it's in your bulletin now so you can get a bit of a check of where we're headed. So this has so far been 2,000 years. This is going to be 1,000 years, and this in the middle is only 7 years. The tribulation period is only 7 years, but it takes up Revelation chapter 6 versus Revelation 2 through Revelation chapter 9. Okay, keep that in your brain. The Jewish temple, back in the day, was considered one of the greatest wonders of the Roman world. Its spectacular position on Mount Moriah gave it the dominance in ancient Jerusalem. And from a distance, it looked like a mountain of gold because of its 9 massive gates, and much of its exterior was laid over with gold and silver. The incredible size of its foundation stones, almost the size of boxcars, is breathtaking. Well, it's now Wednesday evening. It's 24 hours before Jesus would be arrested, 36 hours before he would be crucified. In Matthew chapter 20:21, we see him walking into the temple, the sacred temple, the Jewish temple, and he's flipping over the tables, the money changers, and driving out the livestock, and I believe he's yelling in a loud voice, "You will not make my Father's temple, a house of prayer, into a den of thieves." Now, you got to understand how remarkable that is. Let me give you an illustration. It'd be like somebody walking into St. Peter's Basilica there in the Vatican, flipping over tables, shouting things. How far do you think they'd get? Do you think there'd be a reaction? Well, there certainly was a reaction. And the scribes and the Pharisees, they were the religious leaders. They would be the bishops and cardinals of today, or the popes of today. These were the religious leaders were there, and they were aghast at what he was doing and upset over that. And Jesus left, and then the next day in chapter 22 of Matthew, they said, "We're going to trap Jesus in his words. We're going to trap him in saying something that he shouldn't say, and that way we'll condemn him." And so they came up to him, and they said, Rabbi, should we pay taxes to Rome. Oh, what a great question. Why? Because the Jewish people hated the Rome occupation. hated Rome. And if he said, yes, you should pay your taxes to Rome, then every Jew in the area would nullify him. And by the way, during this time, it was the Passover. Hundreds of thousands of people were there. So the audience was immense. And yet if he said, no, don't pay your taxes to Rome, they would have immediately gone to Pilate and said, this man's an insurrectionist, and had him crucified. Perfect solution. And Jesus answered, you know the story. He said, give me a denarii. He said, whose picture's on this coin? They said, Caesar's. He said, right, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's. Boom. Score one for Jesus. I love it. And then they asked him again. They went up to him, and I love this. They said, this lady, she married this guy, and the guy died. So she married his brother, and he died. He married another brother, he died. He married another brother. And all the way up to the seventh brother, he married. I listen to that story. I'm too logical. I'm going, man, if I'm brother five or six, I'd pause before I'd married that woman. I don't know. Is it her food? I don't know, you know? But seven men that this woman, and they said, so when she gets to heaven, whose wife is she going to be? Almost in a mocking tone. And Jesus says, you don't even know what you're talking about. You have no clue about heaven, no clue about relationships, no clue at all what you're talking about. And then a Pharisee came to him and said, which commandment is the greatest of all? Why is that a hard question? Well, they had 613 laws in the Old Testament, and the Pharisees put thousands of laws on top of that. They made it so complicated, it makes the IRS look simple. And Jesus said, the first one is love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like naming unto that, love your neighbor as yourself. And then he went on the offensive. He said, I have a question for you. And he threw them a question, and they couldn't answer it. And all of a sudden, in chapter 23 of Matthew, boom. Jesus went boom. And I find this, it's very interesting. Jesus was very compassionate and took his time and loved on the people, but he was very intolerant of false doctrine of the religious leaders. And it reminds me, I tell you that, I take what I do up here very seriously, and I know that all the elders, Gary's here in the front and others are here, take what we do very seriously, knowing that we would be judged in a greater condemnation in James chapter 3 because of the responsibility that we have. But look what he does. Now, these are religious leaders, and Jesus goes in Matthew 23, verse 13, he goes, whoa, that's a strong word. He goes, I want you to know I'm hugely disturbed. I'm deeply disappointed in you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Verse 15, woe to you scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. Verse 16, woe to you blind guides. And then he explains after every one of them why he says that. 17, you're blind fools. 19, you're blind people. Verse 23, woe to you scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. Verse 24, blind guides. Verse 26, blind Pharisee. Verse 27, woe to you scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. Verse 29, woe to you scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. And then to top it off in verse 33, you're snakes, you're a brood of vipers. I wish Jesus wouldn't beat around the bush, wouldn't you? I mean, he lays it out. I mean, he draws the line. And he exposes these religious leaders for how false teachers that they are. And we know that later, they think they get the last word when they crucify our Savior. But we know he gets the last word when he rises from the dead. But look there in chapter 23, verse 39. It says, for I tell you, Jesus said, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Chapter 24, starting with verse 1. And Jesus left and was going out of the temple. His disciples came up to him and called the attention to the buildings. Isn't this magnificent, Jesus? Isn't this temple awesome? Verse 2. He replied to them, do you see all these things? Truly I tell you, not a stone will be left here on one another until that will not be thrown down. And while they were sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples approached him privately and said, tell us, when will these things happen? And what is the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Jesus blows them right out of the water, because here's what he does. He's predicting the destruction of the temple complex. The Greek structure of his sentence makes his words even more emphatic, that not one stone will be sitting upon another. And by the way, that's exactly what happened in AD 70. General Titus, the Roman general, finally came in. Rome had enough of the insurrection of the Jewish people, and they came in and completely conquered the people. But Titus was very specific, and he said, do not touch the temple, because it was such a significant facility, an edifice. And yet one of his guards gutted it, started a fire, and then gutted it by fire. And as a result, Titus ordered the temple to be razed right to the ground. And the Roman soldiers carried out the order with exceptional greed by pulling every stone apart and melting off the silver and the gold from it, thus destroying the temple exactly the way Jesus predicted that. Now back to Jesus again. He's now leaving the temple area after chapter 23 of proclaiming those woes, and he's going back to Bethany. It's a 2-mile hike down out of the eastern gate. And you go down into the Kidron Valley, and you come up, and there's the Mount of Olives is right there. Mount of Olives sits about 2,700 feet above sea level. It's 100 feet above level of the Jerusalem. And there they sat down. They look across this magnificent city and temple. And we find in Mark chapter 13 that talks about the same thing. And as a matter of fact, this is called the Olivet Discourse. Why is it called the Olivet Discourse? Because it's a discourse on Mount Olive. Okay, there you go. And it's told to us in three different places, in Mark 13, Matthew 24, and Luke 21. And we're going to look at Matthew 24, but we're also going to look at Mark 13 this morning as we kind of compare notes of what was said. In Mark chapter 13, talking about the same thing, said that four disciples, Peter, James, and John, and Andrew came to him privately, said, Jesus, come here. Can you tell us when these things are going to happen? When is the temple going to be destroyed, and when are you going to establish your kingdom? Now, the questions reveal that they were still confused about future events, because they thought that the destruction of the temple, that the Romans come in and destroying the temple, destroying the Pharisee and the Sadducee system, would create a void that Jesus could step in, take over, and then he would reign as Messiah. They had no clue that there would be a church age, because that's not been said. It's not been taught in the Old Testament. Why? Because the Old Testament talks about the Jewish people. And if the Jewish people would have obeyed and received Christ as Messiah, there would have been no need for the church age period. And yet they did not, and they rejected Jesus Christ, and now there would be a crucifixion and a resurrection, and then there would be an age. So Jesus responds to them. Now keep in mind, this is a Jewish rabbi who is explaining to four Jewish men the future of Israel. And so he explains to them about the temple being destroyed, and then he goes right into about his second coming without any interlude about the church age, because wasn't there to be established at that point in time. And so the tribulation, why do we have the tribulation? Let me go back and remind you of that. In Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, it says this: we have one more week or seven more years left where God's going to deal specifically with Israel to bring them to repentance, but also to judge the Gentile nations. You know, we look today and we see what's going on, and if you're like me, I'm scratching my head. Look at the injustice over here. Look at the injustice over here. Look at the injustice in this country, in our country. Look at the injustice in the capital region here in New Hampshire. Look what's happening. God, where are you? Why do you let it happen? And God says, don't worry, I'm the great scorekeeper. I will take care. And the day will come where God will take care of it all. Now, I want you to see this chart, and just so you see how Jesus explains it, and I won't spend a lot of time here, but I just want you to see, this is amazing. You got Mark 13, Matthew 24, and Luke 21, and as Jesus explains, after he talks about the destruction of the temple, he says, here are the signs. Did you see that word signs? Here are the signs when I'm coming again. And again, there's a difference between, he's not talking about the rapture, because that's for the church, but when I'm coming again to establish my kingdom, what are the signs? And he goes through, and what you'll find are the sealed judgments. He goes, what are those? I'm going to explain to him in a second. I just want you to know that Jesus discussed them. He said, watch out that no one deceives you. The false prophets, which is seal number one. Where there's wars and rumors of war, that's seal number two. Nation versus nation, seal number two. Earthquake and famine, then it's just the beginning. Then persecution, which is seal number five. The gospel is proclaimed to all nations, seal number five. And then the middle of the tribulation, he talks about the abomination of the temple, the second half of the tribulation. He says, again, don't be deceived. And then he talks about the trumpet and bowl judgments. He finally says, I'm coming, and then the angels will gather the elect. And that's all three chapters have those in there. And Jesus is explaining to them what is about ready to happen. I want you to note that because we're going to come back to that at the end of the message, but I want you to know that there are so many places in Scripture that talk about the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so, again, Greg, can you put up the timeline there for, timeline, here we go. So we're right here. We're in the church age. We talked about the rapture a couple weeks ago. And now we're going to talk about the tribulation. We're going to spend 3 weeks in the tribulation period because there's so much there to talk about. And let me show you. Let me break that down to you. Here's all the events that are going to happen in the tribulation period. You're going, oh my goodness, that looks so overwhelming. Now, it's not. I try to put it there because I want you to see that down on the bottom here are the seven seal judgments, that's the S, the seven trumpet judgments, and the seven bowl judgments, the 21 judgments that are clear in the book of Revelation and how they meet out. And then on the top, I put different events that are going to be going on. Now, here's my challenge, because we're going to go through chapters 6 through 19, but in that day, when the book was written, they did not write sequentially. If you're a little OCD like me, I like things done in sequence. Well, that's not how John wrote the book of Revelation. He wrote a little bit here, and then he went back and talked about this. Then he went over here and talked about this. Then he went over here and talked about this. And so it's a little bit out of sequence, which is normal for the writing of that day. But for some of us, it's a little bit of struggle. So I put it all here. And also, there are some things that are happening that aren't in the book of Revelation, but in other books of the Bible. So I put those up on top as well. So you're going to just have to hang in there with me these next few weeks. We're going to open God's Word. We're going to find out what God's Word has to say. But there might be a little bit of jumping around. But I'll try to tell you where we are at so that you're not so confused you're going, oh, fooey, okay? So I want you to know where we're at. So this is the timeline. Now, with this timeline, let me just share something with you. It's very interesting because the tribulation period, when does it start? You go, well, obviously it starts with the rapture. No, it doesn't. And that's something that most people miss. The rapture of the church does not start the tribulation period. Daniel chapter 9, verse 27 says, it starts with the signing of a protection treaty with the Roman Federation and the Antichrist. So there is a gap between this and this. Now, how long is that gap? We don't know. Most scholars feel it's not that long. A couple weeks, a few days, a couple months, we don't know. But there is a little bit of gap, and the rapture happens, and I think that obviously the rapture of the church happens, and I think that would perpetuate what's going on here with the Federation with the Antichrist. Now, we'll talk more about that next week, but let me just say, do you remember back the first message in Revelation, remember that we said Daniel chapter 2, that there was that idol there that Nebuchadnezzar saw, and Daniel said, God is telling you what the future has to go with nations and world leaders. And he said, Nebuchadnezzar, you're the head of gold. Because you're in Babylon now and you're the head of gold. And then there was silver and then there was bronze. And then it went down to the Roman Empire, which were the legs. And then it said, there's another one coming and it's the 10 toes. There's another world power. It's going to be 10 toes, either 10 nations or I believe 10 regions that we're going to rule together from the Roman Empire. And then at the end, a stone's coming, which is Jesus Christ coming to destroy the whole thing. So what we find here is that there'll be 10 regions or nations that are going to be getting together from the old Roman Empire. So whether it's going to be Europe or, and I got some ideas next week I'll tell you about, but the Antichrist is going to be one of those leaders. He's going to rise up and be a leader in one of those countries. And then Daniel chapter 11 says he's going to overtake two other countries, and then he's going to take control. And he's going to be the one that's going to be in charge of that. And as soon as he's in charge of that, he's going to make a peace treaty with Israel. So Israel now gives up their own protection for that. And in doing so, the Antichrist and this world leadership is going to give them permission to build the temple. Now, that is fascinating to me. And I've done so much research on that. Next week, I'm going to tell you what's happening. I don't know if you know this, but already right now, the architectural drawings, all the details, all the engineering, every detail is already in place. All they got to do is have permission to build on the site. I thought about it. The temple is 30 by 90. So some of you contractors, if you had to build a 30 by 90 edifice and you have all the engineering, everything done, all the materials, everything there, the finest, everything, no government hindering you, how fast could you build that? I think fairly fast. And so that's going to happen, and then we'll go on from there. So that's where we're at, okay? To kind of give you the big picture, and we're going to start this morning, and we're going to head down here, and we're going to head down to the seals and the trumpet judgments. They're going to be going on from that section. So if you got your Bibles open to the book of Revelation, let's go to Revelation chapter 6, and let me read it to you. Revelation chapter 6. Then I saw the Lamb open one of the seven seals. Now, do you remember that, by the way, last week? Remember the seven seals we said? It was the deed to the earth that Satan stole from Adam and Eve, and now he is the prince and power of this world. It says in 2 Corinthians 4:4, and John says that he is the ruler of this age. He took it from Adam and Eve that should have been the rulers of the world. And Jesus redeemed with his blood back on the cross, but now the transaction is going to be finished, that he took it from the Father, and Jesus took the seven sealed scroll, and now he's going to start opening it seal by seal by seal. And here we go. So he says he's taken the scroll, and I heard one of the four living creatures, verse 1, say with a voice like thunder, "Come!" I looked, and there was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out and conquered in order to conquer. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, "Come." Then another horse went out, a fiery red one, and its rider was allowed to take the peace from the earth so that people would slaughter one another, and a large sword was given to him. When he opened the third seal, I heard a living creature say, "Come." And I looked, and there was a black horse, and its rider was set a scales in his hand. And I heard something like a voice among the four living creatures say, "A quart of wheat for denarius and 3 quarts of barley for denarius, but do not harm the oil and the wine." And when the fourth one seal, I heard the voice of the living creature say, "Come." And I looked, and there was a pale horse, and its rider was death and Hades, and followed after him. They were given authority over the fourth of the earth to kill by the sword, by famine, by plague, and by the wild animals of the earth. When he opened the fifth seal, I heard the altar of souls of them who had been slaughtered because of the word of God and the testimony they had given. They cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, the one who is holy and true, how long will you judge those who live on the earth and avenge our blood?" So they were given a white robe, and they were told to rest a little while until the number would be completed of their fellow servants and their brothers and sisters who were going to be killed just as they had been. Then I saw, verse 12, then I saw the sixth seal. A violent earthquake occurred, and the sun turned black, and sackcloth made of hair, and the entire moon became like blood. The stars of heaven fell from the earth like fig trees drops its unripe figs when shaken by a high wind. The sky was split apart like a scroll being rolled up, and every mountain and an island was moved in its place. Then the kings of the earth and the nobles and the generals, the rich and the powerful, and every slave and every free person hid in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and the rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of the one seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. Because the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand?" This is the word of the Lord. I share that with you. And let's go back now and unpack that chapter with you. And here we are, the seven sealed judgments. And finally, he unravels the scroll. Go back to the first one there, Greg. The Antichrist. The rider of the white horse, and it's the Antichrist is coming. What does that mean? He comes in peace. And he comes in peace, and he rises up, a charismatic leader who says, "Listen, I can resolve the problem in the Middle East." Can you imagine that? If someone would rise up and says they can resolve the problem of the Middle East, and he does. And it resolves the problem temporarily and gives Israel peace and rides in. The second horse is a red horse. War always follows conquest. When someone tries to take power, there's others that are trying to challenge them. And there are a large sword, and it becomes bloodshed throughout the world, begins to turn in turmoil. And the third seal is famine. It's a rider of the black horse. Still probably in the first year of the tribulation period, but daily food costs will cost 10 times more and be in short supply. Supplies will be reduced by 90%. However, oil and wine will flow normally. So the rich will get richer and the poor will suffer. Think about that. A quart of wheat will be a denarius. What's a denarius? Today's work, about $200. It'll be extremely expensive. Seal number four, it's death. There's a rider of the pale horse. 1/4 of the population of the earth will be destroyed by war and starvation and plagues and wild animals. Did you hear that? 1/4. There's approximately 8 billion people on the earth today. Within the first year, the tribulation period, 25% of humanity will be destroyed. Now, we can't, that is like a number, you say, I can't even comprehend that. Well, let me kind of put that in perspective. Since 2020, 7 million people have died of COVID. And we all know how COVID has changed our lives, am I right? Literally changed the way we do things, changed the way we do everything. It's changed everything around. COVID has changed so much. And I had a friend that has died of COVID. I think some of you know people as well. 7 million people dying is huge. That's a massive amount of people that have died. But here in year one, because of judgment, if there's 8 billion people on this earth, ready for this? Within 1 year, 2 billion people die. Think about the consequences of that around the world. But then seal number five, martyrdom. There'll be those in heaven who'll be killed for their faith during this time. Now, some of you have asked, now, wait a minute, Pastor Rick, how, if all the Christians have gone up in the rapture and the Holy Spirit, the restrainer, has gone up, how do they get saved? We'll talk about that next week. And I'll talk about that in a few minutes as well. I think you'll get the idea. But God always has his way, and always the word of God is still there, and people are going to get saved. But you know what's going to happen? I think in those days, to follow Christ means physical death, but eternal life. To follow the Antichrist means physical life, but eternal death. I wonder if today I said to you, listen, I would like for you to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, but remember, if you do that, more than likely you won't be here next week because you will be sacrificed. Think about that. So it's just amazing the martyrdom that'll happen there. And they're crying out. You look at it, verses 9 through 11, they're crying out in heaven, God, how much longer? God says, just rest for a second. When I have all those that need to come up to heaven with me, then I will finish the judgment. And finally, seal number six, catastrophic disturbances in the universe. This judgment unleashes universal havoc on the world. There's violent earthquakes. The sun will be darkened. The moon will become red as blood. Could that be because of wars? Could it be because of nuclear explosions? I don't know. And it could be. That's why. There is an incredible meteor shower that will hit the earth. And look at that, verse 17 or 16. Every mountain and an island will be moved. You say, how in the world could that happen? Simply by God saying, let me take the tectonic plates and let me shift them. Just take the continental divide. Just take these plates. I'm just going to shift them. And it's a worldwide earthquake. Heaven will be open there at the end of that chapter for a moment, and people will see God on his throne, and they will pray for the wrong thing. They'll pray to be hidden from God instead of being restored to him. Look at verses 16 and 17. And they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide on us from the face of the one seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, because the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand? How many times do we want God to fix our temporary problem but not allow him to fix our eternal ones? That's exactly what they're doing. And then we move on to chapter 7. Look at chapter 7. We go from the sealed judgments to the sealed. Look at verse 1. He said, after I saw the four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, restraining the four winds of the earth, so that no wind could blow on the earth or the sin or the sea or on any tree. Now stop for a second. That's pretty significant. Some of you that know your ecology know that is huge. If the wind stopped blowing, Henry Morris, who is the original founder of ICR, Conference, Institute of Creation Research, who's also a theologian, he wrote this. This is fascinating. Let me read to you. The circulation of the atmosphere is a mighty engine driven by energy from the sun and from the Earth's rotation. The tremendous powers involved in this operation become especially obvious when they are displayed in the form of great hurricanes and blizzards and tornadoes. These winds of the Earth make life possible on Earth through the hydrologic cycle, transporting waters inland from the ocean with which to water the Earth. Yet the angels, only four of them, had turned off this gigantic engine. It ties in with this great famine, which the world was experiencing under the judgment of the third seal, that God miraculously supporting the judgment called forth also by his two witnesses, which will happen later on, that there'll be no rain on the earth for the first 3.5 years of the tribulation. Without Earth's wind systems on the earth, there could be no rain. In the meantime, a great calm prevailed in the lower atmosphere of the earth. No breezes blew on the land, no leaves rustled on the forests, and no waves broke on the shore. Just four angels. Look at verse 2. He says, "And I saw another angel rising up from the east who had the seal of the living God. He cried out in a loud voice and to the four angels who were allowed to harm the earth and the sea. He said, 'Don't harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we seal the servants of our God and their upon their foreheads.'" Interesting, he's talking about those that are sealed. He said, "Before you do that, I want to seal my people. I want to seal my servants of God. I want to put a seal on their foreheads." Now, Ephesians chapter 1 says that you and I that receive Christ as Savior, we are sealed by the Holy Spirit. But this seal is a little different because it says that there's something on their foreheads. It's a mark. I don't know if it's a number, if it's a name, if it's an indicia, but there's something there that says these people are identified as my people. And who are they? Well, verses 4 through 8 tell us who they are. There are 144,000 men. You say, how do you know they're men? Well, chapter 14, in verses 3 through 5, we read, "They sang a new song before the throne and before the four living creatures and the elders, but no one could learn the song except the 144,000. These are ones who have not been defiled themselves with women, since they remain virgins. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. They were redeemed from humanity as the first fruits of God and the Lamb. No lie was found in their mouths, and they are blameless." So these are men of integrity who are virgins, not married, and God put a seal on them that they would not be harmed with death throughout the entire 7-year tribulation period, which I think is interesting. It's almost like Job in the Old Testament, where God says, you know, Satan has this immense power because he's a prince and power of this world, but he can't touch these 144,000. And they will go through the entire tribulation period. At the end of that period, God will use them to begin to populate the millennial reign. Again, when we get there, it'll be really cool when you find out how that happens. What will they do? By the way, who are they? Well, there's 12,000 from each tribe in Israel. Now, some of you that are really students of God's word, you'll look through that list of 12 tribes. You're going, wait a minute. These aren't, whenever Israel is spoken about in scripture, it's talked about in 12 tribes, but sometimes the 12 tribes shift. They're different 12 tribes. You go, how can you do that? Remember when Jacob was blessing Joseph back in Genesis chapter 49 and 50, and he said, "Because I received you in my old age, that your two oldest sons are now my children." And that was Ephraim and Manasseh. So when they went into the promised land, Israel went into the promised land, Ephraim got land and Manasseh did, but Joseph did not, but neither did the Levites. Why? Because the Levites were told that you don't need land, you're going to be with each tribe and be basically their pastor or priest of each tribe. And so as you go on the time, you'll see that some were added and some were taken out. In this case, Dan and Ephraim were not used. And you say, why is that? I don't know. I can tell you that both of them had a really big time with idol worship. And so maybe that's why that they're not in there, but that's interesting. But look what happens. Because that they're there, 144,000 Jewish men who are converted by God, that are living on the earth, they're proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. In verses 9 through 16, it says that it's amazing that so many people are getting saved. In fact, it says in verse 9, and it says, "After I looked, there was a vast multitude from every nation tribe, people, and language, and no one could number nobody could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands. Now stop for a second. They're in heaven, and these are ones who've been martyred for the sake of the gospel. There's a multitude of them, and they're in heaven, and they're praising God with white robes, and what did they have in their hands? What does it say? Palm branches. Okay, now, this is a test. Where do you get palm branches from? Palm trees, good, okay. Palm branches come from palm trees. So where were the palm trees? In heaven. They were in heaven. Not on earth, this was heaven. Somewhere in heaven, there was a couple million palm branches that these people took, broke off, and used them to wave and worship God with. Isn't that amazing? We know in heaven, some of you think heaven is a place that's all sterile and gold and all that stuff. We know at least there's palm branches and there's palm trees in heaven. And what are they doing? They're picking up and waving them. Listen, some of you Yankees, you worship God standing still with only moving your mouth. You gotta have to learn how to move something. Because in heaven, you aren't going to be standing there like this going, oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder. Okay, not going to happen that way. They're moving. They're worshiping. It's amazing what's going on in heaven there. And I love that. Now look at this. This is amazing. Verse 17. For the Lamb who is the center of the throne will shepherd them. He will guide them to springs of waters of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. How about having your tears wiped clean by Yahweh? Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? I think so. What did we learn quickly in chapter 7? Number one, God chose Israel to be his evangelist to the world. All the way back in Abraham, he said, I want your people, you're going to raise up my people and our Israel, and I want them to be the evangelists of the world. And they failed, and they messed up, and they rejected the Messiah. What did God do? God didn't wipe them clean. God just said, that's it, you're done. No, he set them aside, put them on injured reserve. But what happened? God brought them back. Oh, we've got a God of the second chance, don't we? He said, now is your time. In the tribulation period, they finally fulfill what God chose Israel to do. Second thing we learn, despite immense persecution and worldwide catastrophic events, I believe that people are going to get saved in unprecedented levels. I believe in that 7 years, more people will get saved there possibly than all of the church age. And finally, what we learn is God's grace. In the midst of rebellion, God's grace. We'll look at chapters 8 and 9 quickly as we finish here. Chapter 8, verse 1. When I opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about a half hour. Then I saw seven angels who stand before the presence of God. Seven trumpets were given to them. Another angel with a golden incense burner came and stood by the altar. He was given a large amount of incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints on the golden altar in front of the throne. The smoke of the incense with the prayer of the saints went up in the presence of God from the angel's hand. The angel took the incense burner, filled it with fire from the altar, and hurled it to earth. And there were peals of thunder and rumblings and flashings of lightning and the earth. Seal number 7 is silence. For 30 minutes there was silence. It's breathtaking when in heaven. No angel was singing, holy, holy, holy. Nobody was waving palm branches at that point. Everyone's waiting for the next. There's like people waiting for the verdict of a jury. In the Old Testament, a gold incense burner was put into a holy place right before the Holy of Holies, and the coals were put into it, and then incense was on it as a sweet smelling to God. Did you see what it says here? Our prayers and the prayers of the saints in heaven are incense in the nostrils of Yahweh. When you feel like you have nothing to offer to God, but your prayers bring pleasure and joy to God. And these prayers are hurled to the earth and it breaks the silence. Judgment is here. What have Christians been praying for all these years? Thy will be done, thy kingdom come. And it's coming. Look at verse 7, trumpet number 1, the striking of the earth. One-third of the vegetation's destroyed, and the earth is burned from all the hail and fire and mingled with blood. And in verses 8 and 9, trumpet number 2, strike into the salt waters. One third of the oceans turns to blood. Can you imagine the Atlantic Ocean turning to blood? And one third of the world's shipping is destroyed. In verses 10 to 11, trumpet number 3, strike into the fresh waters. One third of the fresh water becomes contaminated and may die. And the word in there, you see that word wormwood's on there? That word wormwood means the word bitter. And this is just interesting. I don't know if it's a coincidence or what, but in Ukrainian, do you know what the word for bitter or wormwood is? Chernobyl. Could it be that there was a nuclear explosion that poisoned the water? I don't know. Trumpet number 4, striking of the heavens, verses 12 and 13. A third of the heavenly bodies is affected. In verse 12, it says a fourth angel blew the trumpet, and a third of the sun was struck, and a third of the moon, and a third of the stars. So the third of them were darkened. A third of the day was without light, and also a third of the night. It could be that the day cycle shortened to 16 hours during this point. Trumpet number 5, the first woe, demonic locust with a sting of a scorpion. It says there in chapter 9 there, verses 1 through 12, contains more occurrences of the word like or as any other chapter in the Bible. John's finding it difficult to explain what he's seen. But it sees that the people are going to be stung and they'll be plagued with this scorpion-like stings for 5 months, which is a normal length of time of a locust, from what I understand. In verse 6, people will not be able to die on their own. In those days, people will seek death, but won't find it. God will not allow them to die, but to suffer. In verses 11 and 12, the Hebrew name Abaddon and the Greek name Apollyon, both named Destroyer. And the abyss is the place of imprisoned demons. And all of the imprisoned demons that God says, these are too evil, even to let loose on the earth, are now let loose. Trumpet number 6, it says this, one third of the population is destroyed. Now think of that. And seal number 4, a quarter of the earth, now one third of the earth. Let me do the math for you. That means by the time this trumpet sounds, which is now about 4 years into the tribulation period, 50% of humanity is dead. 4 billion people. 1 out of 2. Just amazing to me. Just think about that. They say in all of the wars in history, only 700 million people died. This is 4 billion within 4 years. In Revelation 9, verses 20 through 21, we see this. The rest of the people who were not killed by these plagues did not repent of their works of their hands to stop worshiping demons and idols and gold and silver and stone and wood, which cannot hear or walk. And they did not repent of their murders, their sorceries, their sexual immoralities, and their thefts. Can you believe that? The judgment of God, and they know it's from God, they know why it is, and yet they still would not take a knee. You say, well, that's ridiculous. I see it all the time now, don't you? Sometimes I get so stubborn that I'm going, God, why did it take me so long? Chapter 10. Quick add this in there. Talks about a little scroll. Another mighty angel comes down. It's another interlude. Before the seventh trumpet, this mighty angel comes down, an amazing angel comes down, and whatever this presentation was is breathless. It could have been the Archangel Michael, we don't know. But it pictures one with authority, with a feet on the sea and on the land, with a voice like a roaring lion. And all of a sudden, John hears some dictation, and he begins to write it down. And the angel says, no, seal it up. Don't tell anyone what you heard. It's a mystery that we won't know probably till heaven. But in verses 5 through 7, he says this. Verse 6, the end of it. He says, there will no longer be a delay. But in the days when the seventh angel will blow his trumpet, then the mystery of God will be completed. What's that? A mystery is not something that's hidden in the Bible. It is an unfulfilled prophecy. And all the prophecies will now be in the Old Testament are being fulfilled. And what was he told to do, verses 8 through 11? He said, I want you to take this scroll and I want you to eat it. You know, that sounds unusual. What was the scroll? I believe it was the book of Revelation. I believe it was written on it was the book of Revelation, and the angel said, I want you to eat it. Ezekiel had the same metaphor, and he said, it was sweet in my mouth because the word of God's always true, but it was bitter in my stomach because of the judgments that are coming. Let me finish with this. I started with Matthew chapter 24. Remember I said that Jesus spoke about the tribulation period, Matthew 24, Luke 21, in Mark chapter 13. Let me take you back to Mark chapter 13. In Mark chapter 13, after Jesus said, this is what the tribulation's going to be, this is what's coming, these are the events that are going to come, then he gives four commands. And he used the word blepo, B-L-E-P-O. And it's, and the word is in the present active imperative, which means watch carefully. Or you can put it this way, hey, pay attention. Hey, me? Yeah, pay attention. My mom used to say that to me all the time. Pay attention. So pay attention. That's what he's saying. He's saying, listen, guys, pay attention to what? Number one, there in verse 5. He says, pay attention. Keep the gospel clear. The gospel is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into the angel of light. Ladies and gentlemen, there are churches today, and even in the conquered area, that sound like good churches that have good people in it, but the preaching isn't the gospel. When you add good works in there, or you take out anything of the atonement of Jesus Christ, it's not the gospel. And Jesus said, pay attention. Because in the last days, the gospel will be perverted. That's why I keep repeating it over and over again. Keep the gospel clear. Number two, verse 9 of chapter Mark 13. He said, pay attention, be on your guard. Here's an interesting one. Suffering is a part of the Christian life. Some of you, your worlds are so rocked when you say, you know what, Pastor Rick? I'm not perfect, but I'm reading my Bible, I'm going to church, I'm doing my best with my family, I'm trying to be good, I'm trying to check off all the boxes, and all of a sudden, boom, some crisis or catastrophe happens to me. Why would God do that? In fact, often we are shocked that we are suffering as much as the issue causing the suffering. Have you ever thought that suffering reveals your heart? It creates compassion for others, deepens our trust in God. It often is a pathway to wisdom and is an opportunity to praise God beyond pain. You need to know that God, Almighty God, in eternity past, has ordained suffering for all of us. You're going to go through suffering, and it's part of God's plan. So when it happens, you don't go, what's going on? It's okay, God, how do I operate through this? Instead of saying, God, I need an explanation, God says, I don't owe you an explanation, but you owe me your trust. I say the answer to our whys is who? I am God. The third one, look there in verse 23, he says, pay attention to what? Believers can have absolute confidence in the certainty of God's word. Mark 13:31 says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. His word is true, it's living. Mark, Matthew 5 says it will not fail. John 10 says it cannot be broken. Isaiah 40 says it endures forever. John 17 says it's true. Luke 16 says it's unchangeable. And Revelation 22 says it cannot be added or subtracted to. This book is true. And you can bank on it. And finally, the last, pay attention there in verse 33. He says, keep your focus on the goal. It is eternity, not temporary. You know what my problem is? I get my eyes caught down here and not up there. How about you? I get wound up down here. I get wound up with relationships. I get wound up with concerns. I get wound up with the physicality. I get wound up with everything here and things that I can't fix. I just ask God, give me one day to be the assistant Holy Spirit. I'll fix everything for you. Instead of taking my chin and tilting heaven, say, okay, God, the suffering and injustice and the hurt and all that goes on down here, you know what? It's temporary, because someday, oh man, I'm going to get a palm leaf and I'm going to wave it like it's my ministry for all eternity. Isn't that awesome? So this morning, how do we take this? whew, quite a bit. Hey, listen, aren't you glad the grace of God, that if we know Christ as Savior, that we're removed and we're in heaven partying while that's going on? But here it is. But you and I know people who have not received Christ as Savior, that if Jesus came today, they would endure that. And we have the gift to share the gospel. And we have a mission to do that for others. Amen? Lord, thank you for salvation. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you, God, for what you've given to us. And Lord, I stand here this morning amazed at your grace, that we, Lord, that no tribulation and suffering, have no clue about tribulation and suffering that's going to happen. And God, every one of us here, including me, ought to be damned in hell forever. But it's only by your grace through faith in Christ we have eternal hope. And then, God, you blessed us by saying that you're going to remove us as you judge the earth, as you promised. And then you have compassion on Israel to bring them to repentance. But God, this morning, may we keep the gospel clear. God, when you bring suffering in our life, and even though it hurts, may we keep our focus on you, and God, what do you want us to do through that? God, may we keep the word of God sure. And God, may we truly then keep it eternal, not temporal. Thank you so much, God, for our salvation. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're just going to play this last song for you. It's called Thank You, God, for Saving Me. Just use this time as a prayer and reflection on what we just heard from Pastor Rick.
What can I give to you? What can I offer to a king for all the love you show? For all your mercy over me? I called your name, heard my cry out of the grave into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Rock of salvation, my hope is built on nothing less. Morning by morning, how great is your faithfulness. I called your name, you heard my cry out of the grave into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. You gave your life upon the cross, you suffered for all, made a way. Jesus. upon the cross, suffered once for all, made a way. Jesus in victory you rose, made us all your own, we are saved. Thank you. Out of the grave into life, my heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God.
I know in the last few weeks it's a lot of stuff that I'm giving to you, and I struggle with that, but I want to be committed to you knowing that you need to know. And this is something that's important, and so I want to give you the Word of God as it is. And so if you're looking for a church that says, be good to one another, love, be formed, be filled, you know, we're not it. But I hope you understand that, and hopefully in 2 weeks I'm going to let you know about a Sunday evening, a couple of Sunday evenings that I'll be here, and do a Q&A for those of you that have a lot of questions and want to know some more stuff. We can make that happen as well. But thank you. I'm excited about what God has for us. This is an amazing book. As I mentioned it before, not a lot of churches in this area will preach it this way. They take it a different way, which is concerning to me. But I believe this is God's Word, and that we need to know this. Amen? So, Lord, thank you. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for saving us. Know Jesus Christ is our personal Savior. And God, may we hold through that truth. Thank you for the book of Revelation. God, this is not an easy book. And that's okay. God, sometimes the richest the truths are found in the depths of your Word. And so, Lord, as we struggle through this book and try to grasp all that's here, May we do so with an enthusiasm, with an expectancy, saying, Spirit of God, take your Word of God and change us. And may we, Lord, see that you are still seated on the throne, not panicked, not full of angst or anxiousness, because, Lord, all that will happen has already been done from your perspective. And so may we lean deeply into you. May we be encouraged with our salvation this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, Ellen, I love you. God bless. See you later.